In this learning module, we will consider the ways in which Spotfire heat maps may be used to visualize data by first describing the general nature of heat maps, which are like table or cross-table visualizations without those pesky numerical values. In heat maps, the color of the cells relates the value. We will also touch briefly upon the fact that heat map visualizations include a feature called dendrograms, which is a tool for performing computational multivariate data analysis. Let's begin by viewing a very simple data table, where we are considering the purchase of either car A, car B, or car C. We have collected numerical data describing each of those cars in comparison to the same measures for our current car. If we display these same values in a heat map visualization, you can see the color gradient which has been applied to each data column independently. So it's very easy to identify the highest and the lowest values in each column, and the gradient causes color to fade in between, centered upon the average. Of course, this is just a simple example. One of the valuable aspects of the heat map is the ability to view larger data tables in their entirety, because color takes up much less space than numbers. Let's take a look at heat maps in a demonstration, where a Spotfire analysis document has been configured with several heat map visualizations. Use Open File and navigate to the file with Interpreting Heat Maps in the title. Click Open and agree to the terms and conditions of use. The heat maps configured on the pages which follow are based upon this data table, where Megamart purchase amounts are collected from 754 loyalty program customers. In a table visualization, we would have to scroll down in order to evaluate all of the data, even in this relatively small data table. On the next page, many of those same columns are represented in a heat map. Because numerical values are replaced by colors, we can view all 754 rows of data at once, as indicated by the fact that row number defines the y-axis of the heat map. Viewing the nature of the color patterns within each column from this lofty overview perspective might lead us to a better understanding of the data. For example, the shoes column contains less blue than the toys column, suggesting that customer toy purchases are generally skewed toward the lower end of the data range for toy purchase amounts. If we click to sort the heat map based upon shoe purchase amounts, you can see a reasonably even distribution of values around the average. However, if we click to sort the heat map based upon toy purchases, the data is definitely skewed toward the lower end of that data range. If we are interested in learning more about the customers who have made toy purchases at or near the high end of the range, we could use the zoom slider to zoom in on that region of the sorted heat map. Some of the trends which are notable in this subset of customers, those making high toy purchases, are that they also appear to make high purchases in the shoe department and in the electronics department. They appear to be at or above average in age, and their total amount of purchases tend to be toward the high end of the scale. In addition to these continuous measures, you can see the categorical column, store setting, has been included in this heat map. Even though heat maps are generally intended as tools for a colorimetric evaluation of continuous measures, the inclusion of this categorical column allows us to see that our high toy purchasing customers are not limited to any specific store setting. Instead, they represent a mix of rural, suburban, and urban customers. On the next page, this heat map applies the same continuous color scheme to the cells. However, this time the data has been aggregated in much the same way that a cross table groups data for aggregation. Store location has been selected to define the x-axis category, store setting defines the y-axis category, and the cell values are defined to reflect the sum total amount of purchases by color. Therefore, the sum of total purchases for customers in urban Boston stores appears to be just slightly below the average of the cells represented in this heat map, as indicated by the slightly blue tint to the color of the cell, which reflects its relative position in the overall gradient color scheme. Because heat maps are all about color, you should consider the wide variety of color scheme options when interpreting a heat map. The first consideration is the extent to which the color scheme is applied. On the previous page, a color scheme has been applied to each column independently. Therefore, this red cell represents the maximum toy purchase amount, not the highest purchase amount in the entire heat map. Returning to this page, this heat map has been configured to view values in only one column from the underlying data table, and the color scheme is applied at the level of that column. Therefore, this red cell represents the maximum value in the entire heat map. The blue, gray, red color scheme is the default for a heat map. However, other color schemes may be applied. For example, this heat map shows cells colored in discrete segments based upon fixed threshold values, while this heat map defines segment color threshold points by performing calculations to determine things like the median or 25th and 75th percentiles. In addition, rules may be applied to define colors. In this heat map, the top three cells are colored green, the bottom five are colored black, and all other cells are colored light yellow. On the final page of this analysis document, we will touch upon the topic of dendrograms. Notice that the heat map on the left is configured in a relatively straightforward manner to display the total purchase amounts in each department for each store. While it is possible to organize the rows in this heat map by clicking on any individual column heading in order to sort based upon the values in that column, a more robust way to organize the multiple continuous measures or multivariate data displayed in this heat map may be to apply dendrograms. The heat map on the right represents the same values. However, dendrograms have been applied to both rows and columns, which ultimately serve to sort the rows and columns of the heat map. Hopefully, the impact of that sorting can be appreciated in the fact that the lower portion of the heat map appears hotter and the upper portion appears cooler. In an effort to better understand and interpret dendrograms, let's look first at the column dendrogram. The shortest brackets in this tree-like structure are seen here, connecting the garden and clothing departments. This means that purchase patterns across stores are most similar in these two departments. The next most similar purchase pattern across stores is found in the toy department. Due to the longer brackets separating this group of columns from this group, the purchase patterns in those departments can be said to be less similar. If we examine the row dendrogram, you can see that a grouping of stores here are indicated to be similar and grouped separately from other store cluster groupings. And you can see that many of the department purchase totals in those stores are above average. You might also notice the purple dashed lines which lie upon the dendrograms. These are called pruning lines, and they are intended to help you visually define groups based upon a certain level of similarity. Notice that there are two colors of brackets currently in the column dendrogram. If we drag the pruning line down, you can see that we have now defined four cluster groupings of columns, and they are identified with alternating colored green and blue brackets. We could adjust the pruning line for the row dendrogram, similarly, in order to define the resolution of similarity which groups stores to suit our analytic needs. Please take note that this has been only a brief introduction to the concept of dendrograms. As you can see by the information related in the legend of this heat map, the algorithm which generates these dendrograms, known as hierarchical clustering, affords many different settings options. The details regarding these settings options and the subsequent interpretation of the dendrogram based upon those settings is beyond the scope of this learning module.